Welcome to this special feature on JBS. I'm Shahar Azani, Executive Director of StandWithUs Northeast Region, a nonprofit Israel education organization. Today, we are going to discuss the wonderful topic of standing up for Israel in the general public sphere and specifically on college campuses and in high schools. But today, instead of listening to think tanks or declarations from organizational heads, we are sitting on a special panel of listening to what the younger generation has to say and getting a first-hand glimpse at what the experience means for them as they struggle for Israel on their campuses. We have with us today Tomer Kornfeld, who used to be a high school and campus fellow for Stand With Us and is a senior today at John Jay College. Pleasure to have you with us, Tomer.
Thank you for having me, Shahar.
Jen Weintraub, also a former campus fellow for Stand With Us and today a senior at Manhattanville College. Welcome, Jen.
Thank you so much, Shahar.
Sarah Friedson, Israel activist and a former student at Pace University, Pleasantville. Pleasure to have you, Sarah.
Thank you for having me.
And last, but by no means least, Rena Nasar, a Baruch College alum and the Tri-State Campus Coordinator for Stand With Us. Thank you. A great pleasure having you all here at JBS.
Pleasure to be here.
So let's start to have this interesting conversation. And maybe the first person I'd like to approach is you, Rena. As the Tri-State Campus Coordinator, you're in touch with various groups, with various students. And I want to understand from you, is there maybe you can give us a few words about the challenge out there. Is the situation really as bad as we are sensing it to be, reading the media reports and sensing the public discussion on it?
Sure. So I think students on college campuses are facing a number of challenges, one of them being facing all of these different anti-Israel groups on campus that very often cross the line into anti-Semitism with their messaging, with their programs. And I think students also have a challenge of really reaching out to other Jewish students on campus and encouraging them to be part of this movement as well. And the third challenge I think they're really dealing with is how to spread their message and how to educate the larger community about Israel who's not necessarily involved.
So if you were, many of our viewers, their kids will go on campus, will go move on to study, what are the chances you think they're going to face the anti-Israel movement on campuses? Is it very likely that that's what they'll face, moderately, or not at all?
I think it's pretty likely. I think it's a matter of if it's coming from the students or even if it's coming from faculty or surrounding community. But I think it's pretty likely that students will face some type of anti-Israel activity while on a college campus.
So the bottom line would be you need to prepare.
Definitely. Preparation is key.
So, Tomer, I go to you now. In your history, as short as that may be, yet meaningful, you have been both a campus fellow and a high school fellow. Tell us a bit about the importance of preparation and what it was like for you.
Thank you for the question, Shahar. I think if you look at it as a sense of preparation, when you come into campus the first time and you might run into this first anti-Israel activity or anti-Israel event, you might get intimidated or you might get scared, and you might not know how to handle a situation.
What was it like for you? Can you describe that first experience?
First experience, imagine walking onto your college campus and you're looking around and the first thing you see is people laying on the floor with sheets covering themselves, and on the sheet is supposed to be blood, and each of the people on the floor symbolize another victim that was killed by the Israeli soldiers' genocide. So I walk in there and you look at it, and first you don't believe it's actually going on. You look at it with shock, you look at it with disbelief that is going on your campus. But then when you have that preparation that I was able to go through in high school, I knew how to handle it. I knew how to put my emotions in check and be able to go forward and combat what was going on. And I think if it wasn't for that preparation, I would have handled it completely different. And I might have walked away, I might have been intimidated, I would have
So let me understand, you arrive on college campus, but by that point you're already acquainted with what you're about to see. What was that preparation in high school? What exactly was it, and how did you end up going through it?
So the way it ended up happening is in high school, I came across Stand With Us, and I found out that there was a high school internship. So I applied for it. I got the high school internship.
Why did you apply for it?
I applied for it. That has a lot to do with my background. So my mom's a refugee from the former Soviet Union. My father's Israeli, but of Yemenite and Polish descent. So I was raised with a lot of, stories of how it was in the old country when it comes to the former Soviet Union and how Jews were persecuted and things of the sort. So I was always raised with this mentality of being proud to be Jewish, but I didn't really know how to handle the facts and how to handle this debate. And I always had the connection to Israel because I always went to Israel because my father's Israeli, but I really didn't know how to handle the debate on campus and the negative comments that people were spewing about Israel. So when I found out I had this opportunity, I said, you know what, let me take it, let me educate myself. I applied, I thankfully got it, and they trained us on what to expect on campus, the facts about what's going on, how to be able to counter things that might come up on campus or in your everyday lives, whether it's social media or with a friend. And once I got to campus, I knew what to expect.
So if I'm hearing you correctly, with all due respect to the organizational world and the works we all do in that field of Israel education, there is also a considerable role for our families and our background, for what we speak about on during Shabbat dinner, to bring our kids closer to Israel. So it's not enough for us to just aspire to educate them. Sometimes we need to educate ourselves.
I think definitely. I think the problem is that a lot of kids aren't educated, so to speak, when it comes to family tables and things of the sort. So I also think at the same time, the family has a large role in kindling this flame within each activist, and they could teach them how to be pro-Israel or whether it, no matter what they're standing up for, but teaching them to stand up for what they believe in and making them passionate about something.
Right.
Starts at home.
So I want to move to you, Sarah, for a minute. Tell us your perspective of what brought you into this world of standing up for Israel. How did you go through that process and your experiences in it?
Sure. So I went on Birthright 6 years ago. It was my first time going to Israel. Had an amazing experience.
And why did you go on Birthright?
I've always been very passionate about Judaism ever since I was little.
And you say Judaism and not Israel?
More so Judaism. My family is Ashkenazi. Israel wasn't like a huge topic of conversation, but of course was important. And
I imagine not dissimilar to many other families that are watching this us at this very minute.
Exactly. So always had a passion for Judaism. And Israel always lived in my heart. And I'd always wanted to visit. And there was a change that occurred during 2014, during that summer,
so what,
when the
war
broke out.
So you go on Birthright?
Yes.
And what happens when you come back?
I felt way more connected to Israel than I ever had before. Mm-hmm. But I still didn't know so much about the conflict or the history. It was just this connection that I had fostered with the country and with the people. But when the war broke out, when Operation Protective Edge broke out, everything changed for me. It was like a whole new chapter.
How many years was it after Birthright?
4 years.
4 years.
Mm-hmm.
And then what happens during Protective Edge, July of 2014?
There was a spark that lit within me. My mother was actually going on a trip for Jewish mothers that summer.
Right.
And going on the trip during that time period, sparked a lot of controversy. Should I go? Should I not go? And the combination of me just seeing what was going on and her going and being hesitant, and I'm like, you've been wanting to go your whole life. Like, it's the opposite. Like, you can't be afraid. They need your support. You have to go. And it was a combination of that, and my brother was also going that summer, and just all of a sudden, out of nowhere, when I was realizing what was going on and I was posting about it online, I was receiving all this negative feedback from people.
People
that I know, people that I ended up having to like unfriend. It was really disturbing. It's one thing when complete strangers are saying things about your people and your homeland, but it's completely...
And you were in school during that time.
Yes, I was in school. I was about to go back to school. And it was just really discerning that all of this was going on.
So you wake up in 2014, then what? How does your activism for Israel, how did it manifest itself?
Well, when I went back to school that fall, I had discovered that a chapter of Students for Justice in Palestine had been started on my campus. And
Students for Justice in Palestine.
Yes.
That would be the main group that promotes the anti-Israel movement on college campuses.
Correct.
Around the U.S. today.
Yes. Yes. And I was in shock, for one thing.
What did they do? What shocked you?
I guess because for the other years that I had been there, they did not exist, and it was like a new challenge. I had always been involved with Jewish programming. I was very involved with Chabad, started a chapter of Chabad on campus, and a very involved with Hillel, and all of a sudden things kind of took a turn, and I was like, oh my gosh, not only do I need to be involved with Jewish programming, but I need to be involved with Israel programming. And everything that had started that summer, that fire in me was like, you know, I need to bring that to campus.
So Tomer saw a die-in. What did you see?
The first thing that I personally experienced was when they had their apartheid week. And I had a very different experience, I think, than Tomer, because the only real knowledge that I had and training that I had, I didn't have anything from high school or anything like that. It was really just from that summer. You know, the war kept me up on a nightly basis, reading and watching TV. I mean, I was so upset and frightened by the whole thing. I sometimes, you know, had trouble sleeping, and I would just read and read and read, and that's really where I got my knowledge. So when myself and a few other Jewish students arrived at this Palestine 101 event that they called it, it was really nerve-wracking because I didn't have any sort of legitimate Israel advocacy training. I was just kind of trying to use whatever knowledge I had acquired that summer.
From that unpleasant experience of Pleasantville, I want to move to Jen, to Manhattanville. Can you tell us a bit about the atmosphere or what made you who you are in Center for Israel, and what was it like on your college campus?
Sure. So I'm originally from Los Angeles and very close with my family. And from a young age, we have a strong sense of Zionism in our household. My brother served in the IDF. Both me and my sister traveled to Israel multiple times for long periods of time. And so there has always been this love of Israel in my family. So going off to college, I knew I went to a Jewish private high school, so I knew what I was going to be seeing on college campuses. They somewhat prepared us, and it was enough to get by. My experiences on college campuses were quite different from the two of yours. Mine is mostly a quiet campus. It's just the faculty that has a quite loud voice.
But before we dive into the faculty, I want to ask you, the fact that it's a quiet campus, what does that mean for the desire to advocate for Israel?
I actually think it's extremely beneficial. It gave me a huge launching pad in order to achieve my goals that I wanted to bring to campus, a pro-peace message that could bring the community together.
So it's an opportunity rather than a challenge to educate. We know today that unfortunately, our major enemy is ignorance or indifference, and here you have a chance to educate in a proactive manner. Can you tell us maybe an experience that you had on campus of such an educational endeavor that you partook in?
Sure. StandWithUs brought the opportunity to me to bring Idan Reichel to campus. It was the most amazing experience, and I'm very proud of it. Idan brought a message of coexistence and peace and working together with Israel and her neighboring countries. And my community really needed to hear that. The college students really, I think, needed to hear an uplifting message. And not only did he bring that, but he was able to sing for the community, and it was absolutely incredible.
And the event was an initiative of yours, of your group on campus, supported by Stand With Us, or did you involve other groups as well?
So I had a week, and I was able to bring in 10 different partnering clubs and co-sponsors that were some departments on campus. And it was absolutely incredible. I loved it every moment.
So be creative and be innovative. Maybe last question before we move back to Rena. You mentioned faculty. Share with us a bit about that. What's the challenge with faculty?
It's really upsetting to say this, but I think the most challenging thing being a student and working with faculty is ignorance. In liberal academia, it's hard to move a positive message of Israel because they're so stuck in their ways. For example, in my first year, Israel was called an apartheid state in class. The teacher knew nothing about Middle Eastern history, and he admitted that. And so that was very frustrating to hear. But with the training of Stand With Us, I was able to speak up and explain why Israel's not an apartheid state in a very calm manner. And ever since then, he's looked at me in class and anytime he has said anything about Israel or the Middle East, he's looked at me in class to make sure that what he's saying is correct. So now I'm considered like the Middle East expert in that class, which has been really nice.
Very good. This is a case where it's educating the ignorant. But what happens when you have expressed animosity from a professor? Let me ask you honestly, aren't you afraid for your grades? you're sitting there, you're going to be graded by this guy, and you're going to stand up to him or her?
You know, I've gotten that question quite a few times. I don't think the grades matter, and I'm a tough cookie. So I think that I would be able to talk to the administration about that. I think getting Israel's story to teach other students about Israel and who Israel is much more important than
a grade. What's your message to new coming students who are arriving just fresh on campus and have a heart for Israel, and they hear their professor badmouths Israel without any factual basis? What would you advise them? And bear in mind, not everyone is a tough cookie.
Yeah, I definitely wasn't a tough cookie when I first started. I think that you need to be so educated, twice as much educated as your professor. I spend my nights reading about Israel so that I know what's going on and I know the facts, and I would encourage every other student to do the same.
Educate yourself. We kept on hearing from Tomer, from Jen, from Sarah. It's knowledge, Rena. It's education. Tell us a bit about that education. What are we able to, what do students need and what can we give them to empower them? And when I say them, it's very important also for us as community, as family, as parents, to educate ourselves. What resources are available?
Sure. If I can think as to what students need in terms of being prepared, I can think of my own experiences and how I was brought up in the yeshiva system and Jewish day school for 12 years, and I always learned about Israel biblically, but never about Israel politically and Israel's current struggle. And I think...
what they call modern Jewish history.
Exactly. And I
why
think
is that?
That
why do you think... do you have any insight as to why? Why are so many schools, even day schools, reluctant to teach modern Israeli history?
It's a good question. I'm not quite sure what the reason is. I think it definitely leaves these students lacking, and when they get to campus, they can easily become disenfranchised with the new things they learn about Israel, even the things they might not be so comfortable with. And I think it's really important when it comes to education that it's well-rounded, that it includes all different things students might hear on campus, how to effectively respond to those things. So I think it's a matter of the facts and the skills. I think those two need to be partnered to really prepare students for what they're going to face on campus. And the most important message you can leave them with is that they're not alone. There's a huge community of student activists, of professionals, that are here to help them with any resource they might need to deal with what they might face on campus.
Can you give me a live example of something that happened when one of the pro-Israel students on campus ended up in some sort of a mess and needed the help of that grander network, and how that came about?
Sure. So we were working with...
and you don't have to be specific, but the idea needs to be conveyed.
Sure. Students at university at Albany were dealing with the head of the Jewish Studies Department, who was co-sponsoring a very anti-Israel event that had the potential of easily kind of becoming anti-Semitic in its rhetoric and its theme and its message. And at the time when the students first found out about this event, they were very nervous. They didn't know who to turn to. And what they did is they reached out to me, and I connected them to our legal department at StandWithUs, who helped them find the proper channels and the proper coalition of different organizations to help them with the best response. And that was putting together a statement kind of speaking out against this event and having student leaders from all different clubs.
How did they know to reach out to you?
Because they do a good job. I think that's the biggest thing us professionals need to do, is make sure that the students know when there's a problem, reach out to us. We've dealt with many of these situations before. We have protocol for this. We have the connections for this. You have our contact information. Call us. We're here to help. That's what we're here to do.
Accessibility and availability. Tomer, I'm thinking about what Rena just said about anti-Semitism, anti-Zionism, and it seems like, at least from the other side, the Jewish community keeps on calling wolf and claiming everything is anti-Semitic. Where in reality, aren't they just resisting occupation? How do you see the two issues? How do they correspond with each other, the swastikas and the divestment campaigns?
This is an issue we come across a lot, and people ask me questions about this all the time. How do you differentiate on campus between anti-Semitism and legitimate criticism of Israel? I think the biggest problem within the Jewish community is that we don't even know. A lot of people in the Jewish pro-Israel community don't even know how to distinguish between both. What might be legitimate criticism of Israel in one person's view might be anti-Semitism in someone else's. But the definition I like to go by is Natan Sharansky, So he has the three Ds. So the three Ds are separated into three different categories, which is double standards, delegitimization, and demonization. Each of those, if someone's critiquing Israel, and if you say Israel has more to do to advance equal rights for all, then that's a legitimate claim. Every country has more it could do. No country's perfect. Israel's been around for 60-odd years, and every country needs a lot to do a lot more. No country's perfect, so that's legitimate. But if you say Israel hasn't done enough to give human rights to everybody, so as a result, Israel should not exist, that's crossing a line. That's a double standard where Israel's being held to a double standard that no other country is held to. In that case, I would say you have a claim that is anti-Semitism. Right. That's not anti-Zion, just legitimate.
So you're using the three Ds to differentiate. But let me ask you, we're talking about Israel's public image in general. The BDS campaign, the boycott, divest, and sanction Israel, is the modern manifestation of that challenge today, and it's evident on college campuses in what we call divestment hearings. It sometimes it seems from the news that when a divestment hearing takes place on campus, you end up finding a swastika in the dorms, or you get all sorts of anti-Semitic comments. Are these connected?
I would, in my opinion, I would say
in
they
your
are
opinion,
connected.
Tomer, yeah.
Because boycotting Israel, you're essentially boycotting the lone Jewish state in the world. If you track back boycotts, whether it was apartheid South Africa, whether it was the Nazi boycotts of Jewish-owned businesses, that was the connotation that you get when you hear boycotts. So when BDS comes to campus, swastikas are usually found because it's related to the movement itself. BDS is a movement that seeks to eliminate the Jewish state. Its founder, Omar Barghouti, stated that, and he's not ashamed of the fact that he was willing to state that. And when it comes to campus, it sets this divide where Jewish students don't even feel safe on campus. Because when they're boycotting Israel, they claim that they're just boycotting Israeli academics. But then you start, where do they draw the line? Is an Israeli student welcome, even though he's from Israel, and they're boycotting his country? Will he feel welcome on that campus? So I think it's intertwined because the wanting to boycott Israel stems from anti-Semitism that's deep down within somebody.
But what would you say to a BDS activist who will tell you that I stand up for social justice? I want to stand up for an occupied people. I'm not anti-Semitic. I just feel that Israel is in the wrong. Would you put him in the same basket as Barghouti?
No, definitely not. A lot of people think they're standing up for social justice by joining on to BDS. What I would tell them is that I support social justice too. If you support peace, if you want a future that our children could look forward to, God willing, and actually have peace 25 years from now, we got to build bridges and not burn them down. If you want to build bridges, if you want to work on solving the Middle East conflict or standing up for an occupied people, then what you have to do is get the two sides together. Work on having an event on campus, possibly, that could bridge this divide. Work on doing peaceful events, coexistence events, that could potentially send a positive message to Israel, to the Middle East conflict, to the Palestinians, to both sides of the equation. By just boycotting and isolating one side of the equation, we're not going to get anywhere.
Let me ask you a personal question, and I'm posing this to all of you, and please answer in turn. We'll start with Sarah. Once you took the helm of pro-Israel Jewish, pro-Jewish leadership on campus in your community, you're identifiable. They know who you are. In short, has it ever harmed you in any way? Have you ever felt that because of your exposure, you got hurt?
I don't think I was ever hurt in any way because I took a leadership role.
Were you targeted?
I would say maybe not necessarily in the public, but from social media and certain tweets that I had seen.
Nasty comments.
Possibly. Not necessarily using my name. But after that panel, for example, after the Palestine 101 panel, I had heard a couple of things that were said. But I felt very strong.
Have you ever regretted taking a strong stand on Israel?
No, never. Stand With Us stepped in, and they really helped me to solidify what I was doing on campus.
Network helped.
Exactly. They gave me great training tools, and it's allowed me to also help other students and educate even non-Jewish students on campus, friends of mine, family members. So it's I think, really made me into a stronger person and a stronger leader and advocate for Israel. Right. And it hasn't deterred me from wanting to do more.
Rena?
I definitely think when you stand up for Israel on campus, you potentially put a target on your back. I know that even though Baruch, which is a pretty apathetic campus generally when it comes to the conflict, I know during some of the heightened moments on campus, like during kind of the operation in 2014, I knew the students in the hallway who had tried to kind of target our group and the message we were putting out there and our way to kind of bring the campus together around this larger issue and educate them. We knew the students that were kind of talking about us, tearing down our flyers, putting flyers over ours. We knew who they were, and that was very uncomfortable, especially because that's not something that happens at Baruch. And all of a sudden, I'm passing someone in the hallway, someone who I would normally just, you know, give a passing nod or smile, and all of a sudden, I start to feel very uncomfortable and even in some ways claustrophobic in that hallway being there with them. So I think it's
And yet you
definitely
did it.
Yeah,
you did
I mean,
it.
Someone has to do it, right?
What happens if you don't?
Im ein ani li mi li. If I'm not for myself, then who will be for me?
A great sense of history. Mm-hmm. Tomer?
I would say dealing with being known as the Zionist on campus,
which
is
are.
A term they spew at people a lot.
Right, which is a beautiful honor bestowed
upon you. Yeah, it's a beautiful honor.
let's reclaim Zionism.
So being known as the Zionist or the pro-Israel, that pro-Israel guy or that pro-Israel girl on campus does put a target on your back.
And you.
On me, personally.
You. Yeah.
I've been targeted a couple of times when they have their anti-Israel protests. If I show up, like, they'll point me out. There's actually screenshots I have of a social media conversation where someone shared a conversation they had with me, and there's a whole string of comments of individuals from campus attacking me. Like, my name wasn't censored out. It wasn't, like, deleted off the screenshot. You see my name, you see my profile picture, everything's in that. And I looked at it, and I said, there were two different reactions I could have
How
had.
How did it get to you?
I looked at it, and I said, there's actually people that talk about me like this on social media, aren't afraid to say the things that they said, which were, some of them were disgusting things. Like they said, oh yeah, that Zionist, that genocide, that white supremacist, like all these things. And it hurts you, it hits you. But then I remember this quote, and when I was younger, I'm still very into history, and I forgot who said this quote, but he says, if you have enemies, good. It means you stood for something one time in your life. So you know what? With anything you're doing, you're gonna run into people who don't like what you're doing. You're gonna run into the potential chance of someone disliking you because of what you stand for, but that's life. Like, yes, it's difficult sometimes because you know that you're facing hatred from people on campus. People that are supposed to be your students, your fellow peers, on a campus that you're supposed to feel safe. But then I think about the history of the Jewish people, the history of every struggle, and there's always people that have hated those people struggling. For example, Martin Luther King Jr., he had people that despised him, but he rose above them. Everybody rose above them. In every generation, they say there's going to be someone that does not like the Jewish people and tries to bring about their destruction.
Right. Jen, Manhattanville, and still, something that left a mark on you when it comes to standing out as a pro-Israel leader.
I think it's definitely interesting. The faculty on my campus knows who I am as that Jewish girl who does stand up for Israel. And I have heard snide comments to my face from professors, which is really concerning, actually. But the one moment that sticks out to me the most is I brought a speaker to campus that upset a professor of mine. And he wrote an email to Hillel, and I went to approach him, and I said, you know, like, I'm here as a representative of Hillel, and I'm here to have an open and honest conversation with you, and I'll be here whenever you're ready to discuss. And he laughed at me, and he didn't listen to me. All he did was raise his voice at me, but I kept repeating the same thing of, I'm here to have an open and honest conversation, and that when you're ready, I'm here.
And what happened? Was there anything, or that's it?
After that, he decided, the targeting part comes next. He decided to write an email recording what had happened, left out major parts, of course, of my side. And he sent it to a bunch of professors and said, this is what happened with Jen Weintraub, just so we're clear, this is where she stands, and blah, blah, blah. So
not an easy experience,
no,
Jen.
No, absolutely not. It was very uncomfortable and awkward, and I felt alone. I did. It sucked.
And what happened as a result? Were you fighting against it? Did you raise your voice? Did you do anything? Or you just left it at that?
I responded back to the email very politely, and I expressed my feelings to the professor and to the rest of the email chain. And I just said, you know, I think we're missing major parts of the conversation, that I said I was here to have an open and honest conversation about Israel, and I'm here when you're ready to talk. And he didn't mention that.
And on the other hand, I can imagine there is a huge amount of respect towards you, standing up for what you believe in.
Definitely from the outside community, yes. But it's from faculty on the inside, not so much.
Not easy. So it actually leads me to the next point, which is the term community. We talk about students and campuses, and then at the same time in this incredible universe, we have community. How can community help, or what would you tell community to do or not do when interacting with the inside student world?
I think the most important thing for the community to do to support a campus and that campus group is for everyone to be within a unified message and a unified approach. I've seen so many times where a campus group has this amazing approach to what they're trying to do on campus, this really great strategic plan that has multiple steps, tangible steps, and we see community members that aren't necessarily tuned into that conversation, and when they try to get involved, sometimes that can kind of mess with the plans. So
you tell community stay away?
No. I tell community to get involved in the conversation. Hear what the campus group is doing and find a way to complement their plan of action. Let's not do divisive plans, but let's join together and see how we can really create an impact on campus.
The coordination.
It's
working together.
Mm-hmm.
Not above the head of the students, but rather with the students to try and engage and see what's best for that campus. Holistic approach.
Exactly.
If only we were able to unify ourselves more when it comes to our community. Tomer, your view of community.
I would say, speaking of 3 Ds, it's the 3 Es. So empower, mm-hmm. engage, and educate.
Okay.
Where does that fall into place? On college campuses, as college students or Zionists, pro-Israel advocates, whatever you want to call people who are engaged in Israel advocacy, a lot of times you feel like there's nobody there to support you. You feel like you're by yourself in this battle and you have nobody to turn to. That's where the empowerment comes in, where people are behind you and they come and they tell you, keep doing what you're doing, stay strong. You have the community behind you. Just as a student, knowing, like, in the beginning of my experiences at John Jay, I didn't have that support, I felt alone. When the community started getting involved, I felt much more empowered, and I just ran with whatever was given to me. And education. Education is really important for 2 reasons. I think when it comes to handling professors on campus, for example, if you also know your Israel facts, but at the same time you know your school's protocol for challenging grades, for example, or documenting all your grades so that you can't get a grade that you don't deserve because of professor's bias, that really helps you. So you have to educate yourself on what your school's process is for that, while at the same time being educated on the conflict. And the engagement is really important because a lot of times community members try to get involved in something on campus and they make the situation worse.
How is it making things worse?
I think it makes it worse a lot because on campus they already portray pro-Israel students as being funded by like the older generation, and they're not doing what our generation wants, they're not doing what millennials want, they're doing what the older generation want, and we have to change this. And on campus, when we choose to take a certain stance, and then alumni and people send emails and petitions to get this event shut down, they look at it and they use it as another opportunity to say, look who's supporting them, look who's trying to get the millennial voices silenced, it's the older generation. And it damages us, and it's hard for us to come back from that.
So very important to think with the mind, not only with the heart. Rena?
I think another thing that it does is it gives more attention to these groups. It basically gives their events, their programs, their message more publicity and gives them another outlet to get that out there. And that's another potential damaging aspect of efforts not being coordinated and not being unified.
Very good point. Jen? Community.
Because
you were mentioning tough times. A lot of emails with the faculty. You're alone. What can we do to help?
So I'm going to rewind about 21 years. I think it starts right when you're born. I think parents have a duty to empower their children. My beautiful parents have given me so many skills that have empowered me to speak up on campus, as well as my grandpa. And I really wish all families could be like that, that the student feels empowered to speak on behalf of their story, their Israel story, and why it's important. And I really have to say that the answers from my colleagues were really beautiful, and I stand by them. They're absolutely correct.
So going into what you mentioned, Tomer, and you were talking about situations on campus, I want to touch on solutions. We've seen the problem. We understand the BDS movement. We know what the leaders are saying. We understand your needs. I want you to enrich the conversation now with an anecdote or an example of something you did on campus or in your communities as young leaders, because this is what you are. Your young leaders for Israel, the leaders of tomorrow. And I want to know what you did that made a difference, how you countered the attacks, how you stood up for Israel, an anecdote from your experience. Maybe we'll start with you, Jen.
I speak about Israel at every possible opportunity that I can. And, you know, even if it impacts one person, I'm good for that event.
Give me an example of when you spoke of Israel. And you're not talking about an Israel event as such.
No, I spoke about studying abroad in Israel. And it was a pretty large group, and people were like, wow, you did an incredible job. I want to go to Israel. When someone said that to me, I knew that I did an incredible presentation, and I couldn't
have been more happy. So your view is infuse Israel into the conversation in an organic manner, and it doesn't have to be a conversation on politics or BDS. Very good. Tomer, good advice.
What I would say is that people often make the mistake that the way to counter hate on campus is by perpetuating more hate, perpetuating more divide. Martin Luther King Jr. is one of my heroes. What he used to say is that how do you get rid of darkness or hate is by love and light. So what do I try to do by that? I try to build these bridges on campus. For example, at John Jay, it's a criminal justice school. Everybody there wants to go into law enforcement one way or another. So what we did is that we brought two members of the NYPD, two officers. One was a Muslim, one was a Jewish NYPD member. And we had them come in, and it was a coexistence event. It was at the same time when everything in Ferguson was going on, and at the same time they were having anti-Israel protests on campus. So we took the opportunity to bring in these two individuals who were different religions, religions that are supposedly at war, and their best of friends. We brought them in, we had them speak, we invited the Muslim Student Association, we had people from the Jewish community, Christian community, a lot of people showed up.
So the Muslim Student Association participated with you in sponsoring this event? Really?
That's where the interesting story comes in. So originally, they signed on to the event. We shared the event on Facebook. John Jay Hillel and John Jay Muslim Student Association bring to you coexistence and diversity. As soon as it happened, they started getting targeted by other members in the school and members of the community. And they were pressured to pull out of the event. They pulled out of the event, stating that they're pulling out of it for our safety and for theirs. But eventually, they were getting so much backlash that they got so frustrated that they said, you know what, we're not officially co-sponsoring it with you, but we're going to show up anyway. So we had a nice amount that showed up. And it was a nice smack in the face, so to speak, to the people who are just trying to further the divide on campus. And it was us standing up together and saying, listen, we're Muslims, we're Jews, we're Christians, we're atheists. No matter the religion, we're standing up together because we're sick of conflict. We want to put an end to this, and we're building the bridges on campus.
Very good. Cohesive, unifying message led by your group. Think about the brand you want to create and be proactive rather than reactive. Yeah. It's brilliant. Rena, an interesting story you want to share with us, an experience on campus.
Sure. So to borrow one of your terms, I think it's a matter of infusing Israel into pre-existing conversations. And it's not so much connecting students to Israel, but connecting Israel to the students. It sounds like semantics, but the idea behind that is you have to find what students care about, what they're interested in. And there's so many ways you can connect Israel to that passion that they have. So what we would do at Baruch is all the different national months, like Black History Month, Women's History Month, LGBTQ Month, Latin American History Month, what we would do as part of our Israel Club is reach out to these groups that are organizing massive months of programming and say, hey, we're passionate about what you're doing. How can we help, right? Is there an event that we can run as part of your month? How can we help you promote this? And what we would get the chance to do oftentimes, which was really exciting, is have a moment within this month that we can connect Israel to kind of that theme. So during Black History Month one year, we brought in someone who was very involved in the earthquake relief in Haiti with Israel's team that they had there. And we had someone come and speak about all the work Israel did right after the earthquake. We had pictures. We had a band come and play and music. And we invited the Black Student Union, African Student Association. And it was really a very powerful event that was part of this larger theme. And it was a great way for us to connect to these student leaders on our different passions and show that any student from any background can find their own way to connect to Israel and what it does and what it stands for.
I think this is an extremely important lesson, Rena, thinking about that Israel is not a standalone issue. It's not always about Israel and the Jews. The existing anti-Semitic accusation is Jews only care about themselves. So whenever we do an event that's only focused on Israel, it's great, but it's extremely important to find bridges into other communities and express interest in what they care about. And that is a wonderful advice, wonderful. Sarah.
So I definitely agree with connecting with other parts of the school community and doing these big events. But I want to touch a little bit on doing advocacy on a more personal level.
Yes.
So these big events are great. They give Israel lots of exposure, positive attention. Sometimes, though, it's great to just sit down and have a one-on-one conversation with someone. And I just remember how incredibly proud I was. I was sitting down with my roommate one day, and we were having a really in-depth conversation about Israel. And, you know, with that time, I was able to say, hey, like, this is really what's going on. This is what's happening. And I will never forget, she came to me one day, or we're hanging out in our room, and she's like, you know, Sarah, I was in class with the president of SJP, and she said something, you know, that was anti-Israel, and I was able to stand up and completely, you know, negate whatever she had said based on what you had taught me. And it just made me so proud that I was able to have that effect on someone. So I think having those personal conversations can be really beneficial.
Incredible empowerment. So I have a tough one for you, Tomer. What happens, you all love Israel, and what I want to ask you is, what happens when I have my criticism of Israel, when I am not comfortable 150,000% with everything that's happening, and there is something that troubles me? What happens then to your sense of standing up for Israel? Does it extinguish the flame?
I don't think anything really ever extinguishes the flame. I think in that sense, everybody is entitled to their opinion. Someone could be pro-Israel, but still have their critiques of Israel or criticism directed towards Israel. That's valid. You could be a proud American and still criticize some actions your government takes. So I think in that case, it wouldn't even like bother me at all, because he could be a staunch Zionist, extremely pro-Israel, but yes, he disagreed with something they do. Or he's in a different political, he has a different political affiliation than the current government. That's totally valid. I would encourage him to continue. If you have criticism, voice your opinion. Israel's not perfect. We need to work on making every country better. So,
and it's a struggle, and it's an ongoing process.
I actually think that it makes you more credible as an activist if you speak up and say, hey, I don't agree with what Israel's doing. So
in that sense, that doesn't take away from your pro-Israel position. It actually enhances it. So you think that part of your role as an Israel leader is to criticize Israel?
That's an interesting way to put it.
Exactly.
I think that we all need to have balance. And, you know, because if you always are like, Israel's amazing, and you keep pushing that message, people are going to be like, okay. And you're gonna put off a lot of other people. So I think we need to take everything into consideration and balance everything out and really think about the decisions that you make.
So let me play off of this and tell you that I don't see it on the other side. I haven't seen Students for Justice in Palestine rise up or rile up against Hamas or against Palestinian leadership's corruption. Are they doing the wrong thing, or are we thinking about it wrong? How do you see that as a balance?
As I said, I strongly believe in balance, and I really hope that one day Students for Justice in Palestine will criticize the Palestinian government. I think that that would make them more credible. And I think that would be, I can't wait for that day to happen. I'm ready for it.
So like honesty in the conversation.
Yeah.
I want to talk about Students for Justice in Palestine. You mentioned it before, Sarah, when you came and encountered the SJP group and what it feels like. Have you ever engaged with them?
Yes. Yes. Actually...
You tried reaching out?
There was a particular event on campus, I remember. I think it was actually the day that they were doing their apartheid wall that they create every year. And we decided that we were going to have...
Maybe tell me for a sec, what is this apartheid wall?
Sure. So essentially what they do is they create this huge mock wall that's supposed to symbolize what's actually the security wall in Israel that helps to keep terrorism out of Israel. However, they call it an apartheid wall. So they create this every year. And they were having their event, and we decided downstairs that we were going to be tabling for Israel so that students would get to see the other side of the equation. And at one point, I had walked away from our table and came back, and some of the SJP members were over looking at some of the things we had printed out that were factual information about Israel. And it was frustrating because I started feeling very attacked because they didn't like what they were reading, and even though it was very factual information. And it's not a good feeling when you're there just trying to do your own thing, and you know you're entitled to do what you're doing upstairs. We're entitled to be doing what we're doing down here. And it's an uncomfortable feeling when you start feeling kind of like threatened.
Have you, did they try to speak to you? Did you try to speak to them?
It did result in some conflict. They, you know, were instigating and raising their voices, and it, you know, came to a point where actually my Hillel director had to kind of step in and say, like, you know, like, enough. And it was frustrating because we were just there trying to promote Israel and do something positive.
They tried to stifle me.
Exactly.
Rena, are they students for justice in Palestine? Are they our target audience as students who advocate for Israel? Is this an important group to reach out to in your experience and opinion, or not so much?
Definitely not. I think our students are ready and willing to have these types of conversations with people, but students from these groups are very anti-normalization. They don't want to have these conversations. So when I'm reaching out to students and I'm helping them with their programming and their approach, I always encourage them to not focus on the anti-Israel group on campus, and also, in a way, not to only focus on the pro-Israel group on campus, because that's preaching to the choir. What I encourage them to do is to reach out to kind of that middle 80% community who are not engaged, they're not affiliated, they're not connected. But many of them are familiar with the buzzwords, right? They know there's hype, they know there's controversy, but they don't know why. And they themselves will not necessarily investigate as to why. So I encourage my students to be sources of knowledge for them and to engage with them in a number of different ways so that they can bring them to the table and have those kind types of meaningful, productive conversations with those types of students.
I think it's a good point to mention the Israel Matters display, which is a special product by Stand With Us. Sarah and others were mentioning the apartheid wall or the anti-Israel walls. Stand With Us produced a few years ago, in response for these kinds of presentations, a display unto its own that tells Israel's diverse and beautiful story in a very interactive and appealing manner. We actually had the pleasure of this year presenting it at the United Nations building. And as you can imagine, Mr. Zionist leader, the one word, the buzzword that troubles some of the UN officials were the history of Zionism. So as you keep on mentioning, it's important to stand up for what we believe in. I want to touch upon one more important point, which is a point that's not extremely convenient for us old people, but I think speaking with you is social media and its role in advocacy. And I'll start with you, Tomer. Tell us a bit about how you feel about social media and its place in this world of pro-Israel advocacy of ours.
Right. Social media does so much good in the world, but at the same time causes so much damage. And
here,
I'll explain that.
All, yeah.
Here, yeah. And I'll explain how it destroys the pro-Israel movement, so to speak, because there are these channels on social media, Facebook pages, that produce videos, for example, AJ Plus, which is actually funded by Al Jazeera. So AJ Plus, for example, gives itself off as this Facebook page that shares videos for social justice and equality and everything. And at the same time, they share videos that are extremely anti-Israel. And these videos become viral like that. And the problem is when it becomes viral, you have to counter things instantaneously. So it becomes viral, and your friends who know nothing about this conflict see that video and they think it's a credible source, so they share the video, and then you are forced to respond. So I think social media also at the same time poses dangers for us, but it gives us opportunity. It gives you the opportunity to share something about Israel that your non-Jewish friends or your friends who aren't involved with Israel might not know. And they find out because they happen to stumble across your Facebook profile or your Instagram or anything, and they see it. So I think if you use social media the right way, you could put Israel's image out there and improve Israel's image.
With so many voices anti-Israel on social media, why don't just stay away?
I think if you stay away, you're giving the victory. You're running away with your tail in between your legs, and you're letting them do what they want.
So you're active on a variety of platforms.
Yes.
The most?
Facebook.
Facebook the most. Twitter?
Twitter, not so much. Twitter is more instantaneous, so your tweet could be lost in millions of other tweets because within 2 minutes there's a new topic. Facebook is more, people will share it, but it has more of an effect than retweets because they share it and all their friends viewed it and their friends start sharing it and it keeps spreading and then a page might share it. And I'm more into sharing on Facebook than on Twitter.
Jen, social media?
I have a different take, actually. I think that being behind a computer gives you a lot more power and a lot more time to really think about your response instead of you having a conversation. You have, I don't know, 10 minutes. I know that's a long time for some people to really figure out a strategic response in order to educate, not that person that you're talking to, but again, as Rena said, the 80% who are scrolling down, who look at that thread of 100 comments, and you have a lot of power.
Very good. Sarah?
I think something else that's great about social media and being an Israel activist is the community that you have, the other pro-Israel students that you meet, whether they're on campus or friends from like a conference. I think it's great when you end up on social media, you're able to get all these different points of views and also other things that other people share that maybe you haven't seen. So it helps to really keep you updated and on your toes all the time, constantly knowing what's going on because you have this community around you that's sharing all of these stories with you.
So it's an empowering tool.
Exactly.
Rena?
Social media is a tool now where many young people get their only news information. So let's make sure that we use it wisely and that we're not just sharing, you know, the way we think of things, but we're sharing news with people because that's where people are getting their news. So let's meet them where they are and provide them with accurate facts as to what's going on. And of course, for us to correct any wrongs that are on social media that we encounter. But let's actively be resources for people because they're looking to social media for that information.
I think this is a wonderful point to conclude our discussion, if it can ever be concluded. Be active, be there, be present, and age is no excuse for social media. Whichever tool you feel comfortable with, Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat, or others. So having said that, I'd like to thank our participants. I think you inspire us. You are empowering us to know that such leaders, such as yourselves, do exist out there, and we know that the state of Israel and the Jewish people is safe and secure knowing that you are those leaders of tomorrow. Thank you very much for this interesting discussion and hope to continue it in the future. Thank you.
Thank you.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS, the Jewish Broadcasting Service, with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the JBS homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to GEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.